In the series of corrosion, I started with types of corrosion. I hope you have seen the video of dry corrosion and wet corrosion. Continuing further, today I'm going to discuss galvanic cell corrosion. Hi, I'm Neha, and in this video I'm going to give you detail about what is this corrosion all about. Basically, galvanic corrosion or a bimetallic corrosion, as the name says, bi means two and metal means metal. So in case there are two different metals or a formation of a galvanic cell, then that type of corrosion is known as galvanic cell corrosion or bimetallic corrosion. So the first condition here would be two dissimilar metals. There has to be dissimilarity in the metals. The metal should not be same. Second condition is they should be widely separated in the galvanic series. If they are near in the galvanic series or if they are widely separated, that would create a difference. I'll tell you how. Now, basically, if two dissimilar metals are there and they are in electrical contact with each other, they are exposed to electrolyte, then galvanic corrosion takes place. As I said, it is a cell. So you need to have an anode portion. Right, you need to have a cathode portion and then you need to have an electrolytic portion. So what happens is, if these three conditions are met, that means you are able to find out one anode, one cathode and an electrolyte solution, and the metals are dissimilar and also they are widely separated in the galvanic series, then the most probable type of corrosion occurs is galvanic corrosion. Let's say, for example, in this particular diagram, you can see that zinc is in conjunction with copper. They are in electrical contact with each other. At the same time, they are exposed to an electrolyte. So if a liquid is present, that will allow the conduction of electron. The circuit will be completed. Now, out of two metals, which is going to behave as anode, that will be decided by the active nature of a particular metal. I hope you remember that the less noble metal, that is the active metal, as per the series, will become anode. It will dissolve. Now, if you don't remember, let me show you. This is the galvanic series. Now, higher in the series, they are active metal, and lower in the series, they are noble metal. So, if you allow them to conjunct together, obviously, the metal which is higher in the series will corrode, right? Let's say steel screws and brass marine hardware always corrodes. Why? Because if you are making a steel screw in a brass hardware, obviously, steel is active and that will corrode. So basically, if you want to save one metal, then you have to make it in conjunction with the metal which is higher in the series, so that that becomes corroded and your metal is basically saved, right? Like lead antimony solder is made around copper wire. So I want to save copper wire, lead antimony solder can be used. And similarly, you might have been observed that bolt and nut are usually made up of same metal. Because if they are made up of different metal, then there is highly likely chances of having a galvanic corrosion. Yes, and also you have to see that they are not widely separated. As I said again and again, if they are widely separated, means top corner and then the bottom list, that means there will be a cell which is a strong corrosion will take place on the anodic portion. So these are some little examples which you can, you know, remember to discuss galvanic corrosion with anyone in detail. Let us take a case study. It is related with Statue of Liberty. We all know that it is facing a corrosion problem in the shoulder portion. Shoulder, basically, iron is in conjunction with copper rivets, right? And then if you see in the series, where is iron and where is copper, right? Copper is here and then you have iron here. So now what happens is, obviously, iron is higher in series, is active, and copper is not. So what happens, this iron started corroding, and because of that there is swelling takes place, and because of this the rivets actually are supposed to pull out. the saddle were facing a problem, rivets have to be pulled out, and then you know, around 500 600 saddles were affected due to that corrosion. So later on, what they did for the maintenance purpose, they understood that two dissimilar metals have been placed here by mistake, and now we have to make sure that they are not in contact with each other. So what they did is, in between the interface of iron and copper, they used resins or Salek based asbestos and all, so that what happens is they are not in direct contact with each other and the galvanic cell does not get completed. So that is how you can, you know, protect the galvanic cell affected area. You have to just make the contact unavailable. If the two dissimilar metals are there, you just put something in between so that they don't get corroded. Yeah, there are few more examples. Like if you can see, nut bolt are used of same, but then stainless steel is molded, like, you know, blended with the mild steel bolt. So mild steel obviously is higher, so it will get corroded. Similarly, copper and steel plumbing should not be together, that will start corroding. Like aluminium anodes are mounted on steel jackets. So that is how basically in nature you have to find out that if two dissimilarities are there, make sure that they are not dissimilar, and if at all you have to use them, then make sure they are not widely connected in the series, and if at all that is possible, make sure they don't have a electrical contact with each other so that the cell does not get completed. Also, absence of electrolyte can help in this purpose. So I hope with that you are able to understand what is galvanic corrosion. No, I hope concentration cell corrosion I'll take up in the next video. So let me conclude the video by today. Only what I explained was galvanic corrosion, and that is also known as bimetallic. If you have liked the content, please do hit like. That will give me motivation, and do subscribe for more videos. Thank you so much.